Landis, meet Bond. On one side, The Living Daylights has incredible action sequences. Standouts include the mid-air cargo net sequence, the opening chase, and also the chase with the Aston Martin on the open road in the winter. Timothy Dalton also delivers a refreshingly intense debut performance as Bond and brings the franchise back to a more serious tone, a tone which the franchise desperately needed. Then, as an added bonus, the first 15 minutes post-opening credits actually is a solid adaptation of the original short story. But, unfortunately, there are a lot of problems with this one. The first major problem is that the plot on the whole is the cinematic equivalent of one of the toys in Sid's room from Toy Story. They are interesting to look at, but on the whole, they are a hodgepodge. Apart from the tacked-on Bond girl who seriously brings nothing to the table story-wise, you have this ridiculously convoluted chain of events that leaves you wondering where any of the characters are in relation to each other. First, Bond helps a defecting Russian general named Koskov pass the Iron Curtain, and then this general gets kidnapped again, very promptly, and the finger is pointing towards another general played by John Rhys-Davies, only Koskov actually staged the kidnapping to set up John Rhys-Davies, the other general. And then there's an arms dealer played by Mitchell Hieronimo, who has no real play in the movie, save for a final showdown with Bond, which ends almost as quickly as it begins. Then there's also a side plot involving freedom fighters in Afghanistan who are trading opium for guns. All the while you have Kara Malovi, a cellist who's being set up as a patsy, and basically botches everything she touches. Are you seeing the problem here? The whole thing is much ado about nothing. I actually was struggling to think of what else to say about this movie. Off the top of my head, his buddy gets cut in half by an oddly hazardous sliding glass door, the bad guy from True Lies plays a more dignified racial stereotype, and cello cases are practical sleds. Okay, I'm reaching here. This movie is just bland. The only surprise this movie has is that Aha has a second song. In the end, it's just about sussing out a crooked general, and somehow this plot becomes a horrible mess, and the stakes are... well, what little stakes there are just aren't interesting enough to put the work into figuring out what they even are. You want to enjoy the return to the down-to-earth espionage and serious tone that we've been missing for the last few movies, but when you overcompensate by throwing a ridiculous amount of subplots conveyed utilizing bland, boring villains and an equally bland lead female, it's just more trouble than it's worth. And the only thing carrying you through it is the fulfilled promise of excellent action and a competent performance by a solid leading man. For some, that's enough, but by and large, compared to the examples yet to come, you're pretty much left with a hastily made martini.